seen that.
When we celebrate Holy Communion, I think right now we're in that place where we all could sit around the table. So, you know, instead of having the ushers come and, you know, have two parts, if you feel at rest, to come as one grouping. Now, if more people come, then we'll have two table sets. I leave that to your discretion. I'm not going to legislate it, but I offer that as a as an alternative for our Holy Communion celebration. Okay? Second item. Carolyn, is my mic on?
Yeah, Bert, you're good to go.
Can you just raise the volume just a bit? Wally, are you able to hear me without me shouting? And Stan, are you okay with that? Great. Josh, are you ready to go?
No.
Give us like 1 minute.
Maybe just talk about the new year.
Okay.
Talk about how successful the plan was.
So as we are aware, for, you know, we live in two different calendars. Today marks the end of the normal regular calendar, you know, December 31st. And so tomorrow, January 1st, we start the new year. So on that level, I'll say, Happy New Year to you. And you can come back.
Happy New Year.
Great. So you've got a social part, right?
Great.
But for us as Christians, and especially in our Lutheran heritage, we live by what we call a church year calendar. And today, as you'll note, thanks, Joe, Jesus the Christ candle. Remember, there are 12 days in the season of Christmas, starting on what day? December 25th, and ending on what day? January the 6th. Now, I want to just inform us about an event of importance that took place in the Ukraine that you may not have heard about. The Ukraine and its Christian faith is under the Orthodox denomination. Just like there's Russian Orthodox, there's Ukrainian Orthodox, and they tie themselves together church-wise like this. This year, the Ukrainian government says we officially, the government officially declares that Christmas will not be celebrated on January 6th. It will be celebrated on December 25th.
We think it's now, our scene.
You might not see that as significant, but it's the government's way of saying we as a nation are tying ourselves not to Russia.
That's really small,
right? But I do, man.
Okay, done. Done too.
To the West.
We're using the handbook, okay?
To the rest of North America, it is a challenge, literally a challenge, to the government and regime. The Ukrainian people are saying we are not a Soviet satellite nation. No. Do you anticipate in the new year, calendar year, that there's going to be a few feathers that will be plucked in us, you know? I give kudos to the Ukrainian president, the government, to make that change, but the big thing is they didn't stop Christmas. They're declaring that Christmas was past. Now, in the life of the nation of the Ukraine, there will be people this week that will get ready for traditionally Christmas. You know, it'll take a few years before everyone gets adjusted. But still, this happened. Again, why I'm mentioning it now, I'm re-mentioning it again in the sermon. There are 12 days in the season of Christmas. We are right smack in the middle of it. December 25th, what number is it? 1. December 26th, 2. 27, 3. 28, 4. 29, 5. 30th, 6. 31st, January 1st is what day? 8 day after Christmas. And today, we are going to remember an important event in the life of Jesus. The circumcision of him, and y'all know what that means, right? And the naming of Jesus. So I'm going to be highlighting that. I hope I do an effective way of speaking to you so that you can begin to, you know, appreciate the social side of Jesus, the cultural side, but also the importance of, you know, your baptism. So I'm going to steal a little thunder from next Sunday, because the first Sunday in the season of Epiphany is always the baptism of our boys. Carol, are you ready?
Yes. We don't have screens today, so we go old-fashioned.
No screen today. Use our worship book. Okay, so now what about the song from our last time?
733, O God, how long ages past, will be the hymn we sing after Psalm 90.
Yeah. And by the way, our God in ages past is the hymn of faith for what part of the armed services? Of Canada. You know, like you're used to. Bum, 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 bum. Bum, bum, bum. And what part of the armed services in the United States is this for? The Marines, right? That's their bum, 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 bum. Our God in Ages Past is the hymn of faith that is used by the Canadian Royal Navy. The melody of the Navy. Okay? I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to speak to our hearts and minds as we prepare for worship, and then invite you to stand. We'll have the confession of faith. Psalm 90, so turn in your worship book to Psalm 90, and then we'll sing the hymn of faith and carol when we come to that, just again, we can ask, okay? Josh, just make sure our mic's on, okay? Psalm 90, together. Lord, all generations, before the mountains of our world, our
everlasting home, the earth, and the world.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns through you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now. The first reading is Genesis 17, 1 to 27. When Abraham was 90 years old, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said to him, I am God Almighty, walk before me and be blameless that I may make my covenant between me and you and may multiply you greatly. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, Behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be the father of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be Abraham. For I have made you the father of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and will make you into nations, and kings shall come from you. And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you, throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be God to you and to your offspring after you. And I will give to you and to your offspring after you the land of your sovereigns, all the land of Canaan, for an everlasting possession, and I will be your God. And God said to Abraham, As for you, you shall keep my covenant, you and your offspring after throughout their generations. This is my covenant that you shall keep between me and you and your offspring after you. Every male among you shall be circumcised. You shall be circumcised in the flesh of your foreskins, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and you. He who is 8 days old among you shall be circumcised. Every male throughout your generations, whether born in your house or brought with your money from your foreigner who is not of your offspring, both he who is born in your house and he who is bought with your money shall surely be circumcised. So shall my covenant be in your flesh, an everlasting covenant. Any uncircumcised male who is not circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin shall be cut off from his people. He has broken my covenant. And God said to Abraham, As for Sarah, your wife, you shall not call her Sarah, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall become nations. King of peoples shall come from her. Then Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said to himself, Shall a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? Shall Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child? And Abraham said to God, Oh, that Ishmael might live before you. God said, No, but Sarah, your wife, shall bear you a son, and you shall call his name Isaac. I will establish my covenant with him as an everlasting covenant for his offspring after him. As for Ishmael, I have heard you. Behold, I have blessed him and will make him fruitful and multiply him greatly. He shall father 12 princes, and I will make him into a great nation. But I will establish my covenant with Isaac, whom Sarah shall bear to you at this time next year. When he had finished talking with him, God went up to Abraham. Then Abraham took Ishmael, his son, and all those born in his house, are bought with his money every male among the men of Abraham's house. And he circumcised the flesh of the foreskins that very day, as God had said to him. Abraham was 99 years old when he was circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin. And Ishmael, his son, was 30 years old when he was circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin. That very day Abraham and his son Ishmael were circumcised, and all the men of the house, those born in the house, and those bought with money from the foreigner were circumcised with him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The second reading of
is Romans 8, 31 to 39. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height, nor death, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Will you please stand and hear the gospel for this Sunday, the circumcision of Jesus, the naming of Jesus. It's taken from Luke chapter 2, beginning at verse 21 to 22. At the end of 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And when the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to God. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, Christ. Please be seated. And when it was time, Mary and Joseph circumcised Jesus. And today, as we begin, as we look into the 2018 year, I would like this word to speak to each one of us and to reaffirm that as a baptized believer, God has given me a heart transplant, a new heart. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the Christmas season, which is 12 days long, from December 25th to January the 6th, finds us today at one of the most important life transitions in the life of the baby Jesus and Jesus himself. The 8th day after his birth, a new male baby, Jesus is getting adjusted to the world. You know, for 9 months he's been in the womb of Mary, and now he's come out, and he's feeling, you know, air, and he's feeling the touch of the mom. And as new parents, imagine how Mary, as a young woman, and Joseph are coming to grips with the reality that now they're parents. The baby's 8 days old. They got to care for him. They got to attend to his needs. And they also now face a rather difficult decision. I think it's one of these decisions that many parents with brand new children out of the Christian tradition also struggle with. They think to themselves this way: Mary and Joseph, do you think that we should follow the traditions of our mom and dad? you think we should keep alive the traditions of our community and be like everybody else? Or do you think we need to follow them? Maybe we don't have to follow them. What I'm talking about is that in Leviticus chapter 12, verse 2 and 3, God commands every Jewish family that has a young boy to get them circumcised on the eighth day. No ifs, ands about it. And you know, Mary and Joseph are thinking, this is going to be painful for our little Titus, you know? He's going to be circumcised. Do we follow the traditions? Or do we say, no, let's not do it and strike it out on our own? Yet in obedience to God, who has given them the gift of this child that we know as Jesus, and are convinced that Jesus has a plan and a purpose in his life. In obedience to God, Mary and Joseph take Jesus to the temple to be circumcised. And once this takes place in the life of our Lord, once that happens, according to God's word, Jesus now belongs to the covenant people. He becomes, as God has promised, one of God's very own. And so Jesus lives the rest of his life, not for himself, but as a person who's totally committed to follow God's will and God's plan and God's way for him. Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, for Jesus' sake, and like our Lord himself, help us to live life fully committed to following the will of our Father. For we pray, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let this be so for us, people who are covenanted to follow God. For I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I mean, in all my years as a pastor, I will say that when a baby is born, like even weeks ago when Brad and Brianna brought their son Braxton here to be baptized, I have discovered that a lot of families struggle with this question. Do we follow the tradition of our mom and dad, of our family, of our, you know, of our community, and get the baby baptized? Or do we not? In the same way, the pressure of that tradition is what Mary and Joseph are faced with today. Steeped in over 1,000 years of tradition, Mary and Joseph hear from Leviticus that God commands every Jewish family to bring the male to be baptized. That's what you read there. You know that whole Genesis chapter. I mean, you know what's unique about that chapter also, I hope you caught it, was not only was the firstborn son of Abraham, whose name is Ishmael, he was circumcised. Remember how old he was? 13 years old. But who else was circumcised? Abraham, how old was he? I mean, ouch, right? And not only Abraham, but it says every other male in the family of Abraham, whether it was a relative or a male servant, they also had to experience being circumcised. God makes it very clear that to be part of the covenant family, you must experience an event called circumcision. That's what we hear today out of Genesis 17. And then later on, almost 400 years later, this practice which is going around then becomes codified, it becomes legislated, it becomes becomes law in the Ten Commandments. God says every male must be circumcised. And what is the benefit of this? Why does God want men to be circumcised? Why does God want to create a people who are called my people, to be in relationship, to be in covenant relationship to God? Because God wants people, especially the men, to know that you belong to me. You are not to do your will, but you are to do the will of me who has created you. And I've got a plan for you, God. And that makes you then help your wife and your children to do my will. Guys, are you catching this? Are you hearing the Lord's strategic plan in the care and the well-being of a community? He doesn't address it to the women, please, no offense, ladies, and say to you, I'm giving you the responsibility for leadership, for servanthood. He's speaking to guys, to me, to a guy. And he says, you know, Greg, you will know what it means to be in covenant relationship with me. So that as you grow in knowing me, you will lovingly take care of the woman I have sent for you, and all the children that I will bless you. If you can't do this, guys, or if you choose not to do this, guys, it will dynamically affect your relationship with your wife and all your children. Please, guys, as we enter into the 2018, this is a powerful, life-changing message for contemporary Christianity, for men who are in covenant relationship to step up to the plate and to be men of God, so that they show not only the Lord that they will do His will, but you're really turning to your spouse, your companion, and showing her, not saying your ability, showing to her, I will take care of you with my life. Because you are the one that God has given to me to help me as a man in covenant relationship. And then I will also take care of the children that the Lord blesses you with. This is the tradition that Mary and Joseph, this is the tradition that Joseph himself now faces as they bring their young eight-day-old son Jesus to the temple to be circumcised. God commands it. There's no negotiation. There's no, well, you know, Lord, why don't I pass this responsibility off to my partner, let her raise the kids. It doesn't work this way. This is a command, an order directed to guys only. And what's the benefit? I've already mentioned that. When Joseph, in obedience to the Father in heaven, the Creator in his life, along with Mary, his wife, take Jesus to be circumcised. First and foremost, in this family, they acknowledge that they do not rule their lives, but it is God who rules their life. It is God who becomes unto them the one and only reason why they live. I will give you as an everlasting possession, you and your descendants after you, this, and there's a quote, I will be Daryl, you read that in Genesis. Genesis chapter 17, verse number 8. Why do they want Jesus to experience being circumcised? Because in his life as an 8-day-old child, so whenever he's going to die, Jesus will know in his life that God is real, that God exists, that it isn't just an idea, a theory, it isn't just a tradition, but God literally is with him. And this is the conviction that Mary and Joseph want their son Jesus to have. That God is with them. But also a second reality takes place. Because God is with Jesus now, literally Emmanuel, Jesus knows that each and every day God will take care of him. In eating and working and play, that God has a plan for him because his heart, not just his mind, but his heart, knows that the real presence of God in his life will take care of him. In other words, his heart, Jesus' heart, has been opened and changed, transferred, alive to the real presence of God Almighty. Romans chapter 2, verse 28. A man is not a Jew if he is only one outwardly, nor is circumcision merely outward and physical. No, a man is a Jew, and Jesus, remember, faces this reality, he lives in this reality. A man is a Jew who is one inwardly, and circumcision is circumcision of the heart by the Holy Spirit, not by the law. Such a man's praise is never from men, but it is always from God. So again, this is what Jesus receives when he's 8 days old as a gift, literally, as a gift given to him by his mom and dad when they bring him to the temple to be circumcised. He knows that God is real in his life. He knows that God is going to take care of him. He knows that God has a plan for him. And they teach him and he becomes aware that God's plan for Jesus, as the angel Gabriel has said, is for what reason? Yes, Don, say that again. Oh, Christian. To save people from their sins. That's what God's plan is for Jesus as a covenant child. God has a plan for him. And right early in his life, his mom and his dad, and in his own life, he keeps hearing them over and over and over again. So that when that last hour in his life comes, and we know what that last hour is, it's there at Calvary. When he's at the garden, and he's asking his Father in heaven, do I really have to go through this? Do I really have to bear the suffering of humanity in my life? Do I have to descend into hell and do battle against the evil one and all the dominions therein? Do I really have to do it? The Father says to him, yes. This is my will for you. This is my plan to save people from their sins. And throughout your whole life, Jesus, because you've been part of this covenant relationship with me, and I have never failed you, I will take care of you, even to the last moment when you cry out, it is finished. But I'm not going to leave you in the grave, my son. I will also raise you from the dead. And you will sit at my right hand. And together, we shall judge. Together we shall rule. Together, you know, we will be who we are. This is my promise for you, Jesus, as a covenant child, which began on the 8th day in his life, because he became circumcised. I would like to say amen. Sermon is done. How many would agree to that if it didn't happen? Yeah, no, it ain't gonna happen. So I want to just switch. I talked about circumcision. Now I want to highlight that. At this point in the message, I want to take a little thunder away from next Sunday that's coming. Elder Dave will be the preacher. The first Sunday in the season of Epiphany is called Baptism of Jesus Sunday. It focuses on Jesus who is baptized. Please note, when Jesus gets baptized, he does not become a covenant person at that point in his life. That's already taken place. When did that take place? When he was circumcised. Early in his life, that's when he became the covenant child. Today, right now, I just want to highlight, and I take this from reading Luther, late in his life, the last 20 years, he wrote about the book of Genesis, and there's a set of commentaries, 8 volumes long, and they're like 300 pages of book. That's a lot of writing. And, volumes 1 to 8 in Luther's works, it's volume number 3, he writes about this chapter. And he makes it very clear, not only in this volume, but in the rest of them. We, as Gentiles, we don't need to be circumcised. Jesus did not command Gentiles to be circumcised. That's strictly for, guess who? The Jews. That's how the Jewish person becomes a member of God's covenant family. This law is strictly for the Jews. Are you catching that? But then how did we become part of God's covenant family? Somebody said it. Louder?
Baptism.
Through baptism. This is how we, the Gentiles, get grafted into God's family. Through baptism, we become circumcised of the heart to become a son and a daughter of the one true God. And it is not just for men only. Guess what? It includes, ladies, now you can say it. Take your fingers and go like this. It includes me. And when I become a baptized believer, I can stand next to the guy who is also a baptized believer and say, there is equality between us. In Christ Jesus, you who are baptized, you are neither Jew or Greek, male or female, slave or non-slave, but you are all one and equal in the Lord Jesus Christ. So that the man of God who is now baptized as a Gentile works really clearly and closely with his wife, who is not only his helpmate, but is one together with the Lord. And together, you work doing the will of the Father in your family. Are you catching that? This is life-changing to the contemporary scene. No longer do women rule over men and say, we're not ruling the church. We're going to have that voice in the congregation. And no longer does the man say to the woman, be quiet. Know your place, ladies. You will never tell us how to rule. Together as baptized believers, as people of the covenant of God, we work hand in hand together doing the will of God our Father who has made us a covenant child, because on the 8th day in our life, we became together, what's the word? We experienced a baptism into Christ Jesus. When the word, and Jesus said, go into all the nations, make disciples in my name, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. When this word in the command of Christ is connected to this water, it becomes a living event.
Christ Jesus circumcises our heart so that we have a new heart and a new life, and we become a child, a covenanted child of God Almighty, so that we know that God is real and that God will take care of us here as a community, as an individual. Again, what is the primary benefit that we receive from Jesus as a covenant person? What's Jesus' plan in our life? What's Jesus' plan for his life? To save people from their sins as a baptized believer. Whether you are male or whether you are female, you come to Christ Jesus today. And in this worship celebration, right at the very beginning, and in just a minute, he will invite you to come to his table, to enjoy his meal, to eat of his true body and his true blood, so that you experience, as a baptized believer, the real purpose of why Jesus was born on Christmas. Take and eat. Take and drink. So that you may know in your life, and you know the rest of the phrase, right? That you may know in your life, that you have no doubt in your life, that because of me, all your sins are forgiven. Did anybody hear sin? No. That's what the confession of sin was already. You know? You may not tell me or your spouse, you know, all the little intimate details of the sins you commit, you know, and do not be shocked when, oh, I've sinned against my sister or my brother. That's who we are. We are together. We are called sinners. But we come to Jesus this morning to become forgiven sinners. Not Pharisees. Not some kind of holy, pious person that talks about Jesus this way and that way. We come to Jesus because we know that as a covenant child, he and he alone touches my heart with his real presence so that I can know that I'm forgiven. And once you leave this table, knowing that Jesus forgives you, please smile. Let's all practice that. It's like the practice the aha moment, together the aha moment. You know, when we leave this table, it's a table for joy. All your sins are forgiven you. The sin sickness that we have that will kill us physically and spiritually, that sin sickness has the remedy in you now. His name together is Jesus, the child born in Christmas, the man who lived and showed the world what the kingdom of God is about, the one who willingly gave his life for the whole world, who suffered and died for me, the sick sin sinner, but who was raised from the dead and now lives within you, within me. He gives us hope. So that as we look into 2018, whatever the events may happen, we cry out with joy and hope. Thanks be to God that as a baptized believer, that as a person whose heart has been circumcised by the Holy Spirit, I know that I am a son and a daughter of God. Through Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior, to which all God's people said, Amen. Let us pray. Come now, Holy Spirit, and through the rest of our worship celebration, we ask that you would fan to flame the Lord Jesus in us, that his life becomes the all-consuming passion, because you have renewed our heart, you have renewed our mind. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Will you please stand? And I believe it was
turn to the very back of your worship book. The very, very back. The very back. It should be the words of the Apostles' Creed here. Am I correct? And together let us as sons and daughters, as covenant people, as baptized believers, confess our faith, your personal faith, in the Apostles' Creed. And together, I believe.
Thank you.
Together we pray thee, our Father. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke this bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also Jesus took the cup after the supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave this cup to them all and said, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. We sing Lamb of God. Communion assistant, please come forward.
The Lord provides people for grace.
Even though we may wonder what's all going on, it's His presence, it's His life, it's His forgiveness of sins that you experience that draws people here to Jesus. You know, it's to Jesus they come. You've come today to Jesus. And He gives you His life, His grace, His power. So that when you enter 2018, your hope is in Him, not me. Does that make sense, everyone? Right now you can enjoy the fellowship and the meal that our Lord provides. Ready, John? Take and eat. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is given for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. Take and eat. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is given for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. Continue, Jesus, to lead and guide through each and every day in His life, always to you. Amen. Take and eat. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is given for you. Amen. Take and eat. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is given for you. Together, Holy Spirit, continue to lead and guide me close to Jesus so that He knows this day and forever that His sins are forgiven Him. Amen. Take and eat. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is given for you. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is shed for you and shed for all people for the forgiveness of all your sins and your sin. Amen. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of all your sin and all your sins. Amen. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of all your sin and your sins. Amen. Take and drink the true blood of Jesus. Now, Carolyn, when we go back, may we sing the chorus, O come, let us adore Him. You know, for He alone is worthy. And now may the true body and the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ keep you and strengthen you unto life everlasting. Know this day, and I want to say, and into 2018 and 19 and 20 and on, that Jesus has forgiven you all your sin and all your sins to the glory of God the Father Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. You are dismissed. So go back and sing the chorus, O come, let us adore Him. And then yellow.
Thank you.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon us now and forevermore. Amen. Please be seated for parish announcements.
Good morning, all my brothers and sisters in Christ. I quickly would like to take this time to, from Karen and myself and our little dog Keisha, to wish everybody in the congregation a very happy new year, along with all your family members. And also, one more announcement, Art and Erna are here. But I'd like to take this time to wish them a very happy 60th wedding anniversary. Okay. Men's breakfast, Saturday, January 6th at 8:30 a.m. The first breakfast was excellent, and I encourage all men to attend this one. Movie night, Tuesday at 7:00 p.m., Sarah's Choice. Based on the tragic but faith-filled story of Rachel Jo Scott, who died during the violent Columbine High School shooting in 1999. And I am supposed to remind the congregation that there is help needed next Sunday after service to put away the tree. Thank you. Anybody else got anything else?
Ken? Tom? Go ahead.
As usual, just to keep people as informed of what's happening, this week, just to make people aware, we had a lady.
I think it's a glitch from
David. She's come here. And anyway, came on Thursday, allergic reaction to some of the Mexican chicken something. Sleeping all over, could barely walk. Unfortunately, she missed her, acupuncture appointment. She came over, she made sure she didn't miss our appointment. We hope we had about Eric over here and gave her a prayer. Barely moved, and after one prayer, all of a sudden, her arm, I couldn't move it any more higher than here, went up to here, no problem. And we, anything else need me? Oh yeah, my lower back is still. We prayed again, pain in her back, pain in the back is still. And then she was walked back to the back, you know, just to the door to leave. Wow, what a difference in walking. So, my people, you know, our congregation doesn't know well what's going on here, but the message here is for the people that are listening on the TV set, that call of grace, the healing team is available for you. That as Kristen jumped, you have to wait. Because she said she started to get ill on December the 9th when she finally showed up. You know, this last Thursday. Don't hesitate. Jesus is more than willing to pray and heal you. That's our message.
Give thanks to the Lord.
Just further to the announcement for the men's breakfast, the last thing to sign up is today, just so we have a head count. Grace Center Fellowship, so we know, so we know how much to purchase. So sign the sheet in the back. If you want to bring your name, put your name down too, so we know you have that. Then bring them. Buy a breakfast, $5. But it's a cheap way to get some fellowship. A little bit of sin in the breakfast.
I need.